Welcome to the Science for the Public lecture series. Science for the Public is an organization committed to bringing science information and issues to the general public. Visit our website for our program listings and blog. Good evening. I'm Yvonne Stapp for Science for the Public, and I welcome you to Contemporary Science Issues and Innovations. Tonight, our guest is Barnabas Daru, a research fellow in Organismic and Evolutionary Biology at Harvard University. Dr. Daru received his Ph.D. in Biology in 2015 from the University of Johannesburg, South Africa, and then came to Harvard, where his research on seagrasses is a serious contribution to both marine botany and marine ecology, especially at this time of environmental stress. His focus is on evolutionary and ecological forces that affect marine biodiversity. Dr. Daru uses the most sophisticated analytic methods so as to guide conservation decisions at both the local and global scales. Despite the critical role of seagrasses, we in the general public do not hear much about them. So tonight we are in for some surprises. We learn why seagrasses are indispensable in marine ecosystems, and we learn also how development, pollution, and climate change are affecting seagrasses and the many organisms that depend on them. And finally, we learn what Dr. Daru and other scientists in this field are trying to do to revive and conserve seagrasses. We are really delighted to welcome Dr. Barnabas Daru. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, Yvonne.
And we really appreciate your coming by and helping us out with this topic, which we are bound to hear a great deal more. We don't get information about seagrasses, and so immediately we in the general public think seaweed.
Right.
So could you give us a little background? What's the difference, if there is? Are we mixed up?
All right. Thank you very much. Seagrasses are not grasses.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, but they are so named simply because they look like grasses. They are greenish in color, but then they look like normal terrestrial grasses. But what distinguishes them from land plants is there are so many adaptations that they have evolved over time to move into the sea. And so people often confuse seagrasses for seaweed. Seagrasses are flowering plants, they're angiosperms, whereas seaweeds are algae.
Ah.
So these are totally two different organisms. And so how you can tell seagrasses is simply because they are flowering plants. They can produce flowers like other terrestrial plants, and they can undergo pollination. They also photosynthesize, as the ability to make food from the energy trapped from the sun on their own. So they are primary producers in an ecosystem, in this case, the marine environment.
That's really interesting. So did they evolve from land plants then and adapt to?
Right, so seagrasses evolved from land plants, and then they move back into the sea. So first, to track one step backwards, plants evolve from the sea, and then they move on to the land. But then seagrasses then went back into the sea 100 years ago. And so they made a transition into the sea, and as a result, they lost some adaptations that land plants still have. For example, the stomata, which is used for gaseous exchange, is literally lost in seagrasses. Yeah, and then they can also survive in very high saline environments. So they have to deal with constant changes in osmotic pressure in the marine environment, in which land plants cannot undergo that kind of changes. So those are some of the adaptations that they have. Yeah. And also, they also can pollinate inside water, submerge inside marine water. And their pollination, unlike normal terrestrial plants, which rely on other organisms like insects, birds, mammals, sometimes wind, for pollination, seagrasses rely on water currents to move their pollen from one organism to the other. And so pollination is strictly via water.
That's quite an adaptation, right. A list of adaptations. That's really fascinating. And then there are all kinds of seagrasses, is that correct?
Right. So there are 72 species of seagrasses worldwide. And these are distributed in different ways. So some of them are widespread, found across all the coastal regions of the world. For example, the eelgrass, Zostera marina, you can find it along all the coastal regions of the Northern Hemisphere. Whereas there are some species that are very localized in their distribution, found in very specific areas and nowhere else in the world. So example is one that you find in Hawaii, which is the Helophila hawaiana, and another also found on the east coast of North America, which is in Bermuda, is also called the Helodule bermudensis, so it's only found there. There are also some species that are found localized in some parts of southwestern Australia. They're also localized, so their distribution is very remarkable. And it's important to also note that seagrasses are not a taxonomic group, so they evolve independently, at least in five lineages. So so these are, unlike some plants that evolve from one common ancestor, these are independently evolved. They only share the similar habit of living inside marine environment. So they are not a taxonomic group, but they are an ecological group.
Is that something? Then on top of that, they're so critical, apparently, to the marine ecosystems?
Right. So it's interesting to know that in the marine environment, at least there are two major groups of flowering plants that are found within the marine environment. So one is the seagrasses that we're talking about, and then the mangroves, which also evolve independently in different lineages. So for seagrasses, they evolve to dominate the coastal areas, but then they are submerged inside marine environment. And so their distribution is, it's found across the coastal regions, but then mostly the high richness of species are found in this Indo-Pacific regions of the world and some parts of Australasia. Whereas if you move toward the western part of the world, moving from the central Indo-Pacific regions to what's the coast of Africa, then the species diversity start declining. And then when you get toward the parts of the Americas, South America and North America, then species diversity declines, such that, for example, along the Boston Harbor, we have just two species, the eelgrass and Rupia maritima, which are the key species that you find along the coastal areas of the north eastern part of North America.
I see. So the diversity itself is very mixed around the world. I think you pointed out there are some that just clone themselves and others that reproduce sexually.
Right.
And could you give us a little information about that?
So like other terrestrial plants, seagrasses can also reproduce clonally, such that that's vegetative reproduction, but they also can reproduce sexually as well. So clonally is just because if you look at the morphology of seagrasses, they have like running stems,
yes,
which means they can actually keep reproducing, you know, clonally, as long as, you know, one stem can be transplanted to another locality, and then it keeps growing and reproducing. So one individual can, you know, reproduce multiple times to dominate an entire area. So like I mentioned about the distribution that moves from the eastern to the western part, as it moves from east to west, it declines. So also in those parts of the west where you find low species diversity, most of the time you see a vast area dominated by just one species. And sometimes in that case, it's usually like clonal reproduction that's happening there. And so there are many ways to explain why you have high diversity in the eastern part of the region of the world versus the western part of the world. So first, the diversity of animals that depend on seagrasses also move from the east to the west. So for example, seagrasses are very important in the diet of many marine animals. So the sea cow, the dugong, grazes on seagrasses. The green sea turtle feeds exclusively on seagrasses and nothing else. A whole lot of other animals depend on seagrasses, some directly, some indirectly. So the ones that depend indirectly on seagrasses can be fish and some other invertebrates. So most of them rely on seagrasses for laying their eggs, and they use the seagrass beds as attachment substrates. So when they lay their eggs, the stringy eggs can attach to the seagrasses, you know, as a substrate, such that underwater current cannot sweep them easily away. So, and eventually when the eggs hatch, they can also use the seagrass beds as a hiding place from predators. So apart from that, seagrasses also perform other key ecosystem roles like carbon sequestration, sucking in excess carbon that is released in the atmosphere and trapped in the ocean. So they suck this up. They also, one of the most important services they perform is in accumulating sediments in the ocean. So that way, as the leaves are very good traps for sediment. So pollutants released into the marine environment can easily be trapped on the leaves of seagrasses. As a result, they help to purify the water. So those are some of the roles they play in the ecosystem.
Could I just get something straightened a little more here? That you said that they are great carbon sequestration. So can you give me any idea of like how much? I've seen that they produce a huge amount of oxygen for the sea, and they pull out a large amount of CO2. So is it really that significant?
Right, yeah, so that's one of the most important role they play, considering that they are they form one of the major groups of flowering plants in the marine environment. Yeah. So, like I mentioned, their distribution is found around the coastal regions of the world. And along the coastal regions of the world, that's where you find also lots of human population lives around the coastal regions. So as a result, there's so much pollution, much human activity going on along the coastal regions. As a result, they pollute the environment. They release lots of waste product. They release lots of carbon, lots of nitrogenous waste. And these are the organisms that are at the receiving end. Because they are primary producers, they have to take up all these excess chemicals and waste that has been released as a result of human activities. And they take them up. But then one thing is food chain. So within the food chain, plants are usually at the beginning of the food chain. They are primary producers. So organisms that depend on the primary producers are the herbivores, which I mentioned, sea cows, the dugongs, the manatees.
Turtles.
Yeah, the turtles. They feed on these. And when these primary consumers, that's the herbivores, feed on the seagrasses, then they are in turn eaten by other large predators like the sharks. And so all this has cascading effect. But then one thing also is that some of the pollutants that are released also get deposited inside of the seagrasses. And when they are consumed, then it leads to secondary poisoning, like lead poisoning or other bioaccumulation that can happen, and eventually it gets up, it gets accumulated into the tissues of even top consumers like the predators I mentioned, the carnivores, sharks, and other organisms that depend on all those other animals that feed on seagrasses.
Dr. Daru, you've been very concerned with the loss of the seagrasses. Apparently this is happening on a global scale. That's one thing. But the other is this pollution from development and so on that puts so much, and agriculture puts so much contamination in the water, is that a contributing factor to the loss of the seagrasses as you study?
Right. So, yes, that's a very big concern for me when I started learning about seagrasses, that these are organisms that people take for granted. People go to the beach. Most of the time, they get excited looking at sharks, at whales, at other animals. But then seagrasses are always kept to the background, and people often look at them as just plants, and they are just there in the background doing, you know, they ignore the fact that they are actually at the beginning of the food chain, and anything that happens to seagrasses will have a cascading effect on all the other organisms that depend on it, including humans. So what got me intrigued is human activities in the form of boating, you know, like, or dredging activities which destroy vast acres of seagrass beds. But most of the time, because people don't really understand or know more about these plants, they often feel it's a way of cleaning the bottom of the ocean or the bottom of the aquatic environment, whichever, depending on the locality where the seagrasses are found, it can be a bay or a harbor. So sometimes the dredging activities come across as if they are just cleaning and getting rid of the seafloor of waste, or just like you clear off your backyard or your garden for weeds, they also clear off these without fully understanding the role that these plants are playing in the environment.
And I guess that has a very long range effect too, because as you said, they affect the whole food chain.
Right.
When the disruption affects it, but also the pollutants themselves.
Right. So, so all these activities are affecting seagrasses in very big ways. So like I mentioned previously also, that some of the seagrasses are very restricted in their distribution, but because not much information is known about seagrasses, there is a high chance of some of them getting extinct as a result of the human activities. And so most of them look almost the same, except if they're in flowers, it's difficult to tell them apart. So in some instances, you might also mistaken an endangered one or one that is highly threatened for one that is less threatened. But because there is no much information about seagrasses, then the threat just keeps on piling, and not much is known about the threats that is faced by all the, by these plants.
Right. Yeah. What is the level of, like, I don't know whether to say the word extinction with these things. Is it very, very widespread and large now? Is it very significant, the loss of some of these critical species?
So, yes. So, seagrasses are also feared to go extinct in the nearest future. So, recent study shows that at least 7% of seagrass area is lost each year. 7% is lost each year. So remember, if you put all the distributional range of seagrasses worldwide, they can fit into the size of Madagascar. So if 7% of their range is, you know, lost every year. So you can do the math. Just in
it doesn't
years,
take long.
Then
it's gone.
You might lose
and
all
with
of them.
That, a lot of marine life.
Right.
Is that right?
Yes.
I mean,
so,
they because they depend on it.
Right. So, and because of that interdependency, it got me curious. So I wanted to find out more about the level of protection, the conservation efforts that have been done for seagrasses and other marine plants. And it was shocking to find that there are some conservation efforts that have been put in place, but sadly, they have been designed to protect animal species. So mostly have been designed to protect sharks, dolphins, whales, corals. But then the animals that are at the beginning of the food chain are only incidentally included in the protection efforts. So then I decided to explore and find how much of the seagrasses and other marine plants are protected by the current marine reserve network.
Yeah.
And we found that a huge portion of the seagrass and other marine plants diversity is still left unprotected. And so that's a very big concern, because since they are now declining, at least 7% of their ranges is declining. So one of the goals is to raise that awareness from a scientific point of view to the policymakers, so they can know the importance of these plants. And so they can also expand their conservation efforts to protect all these other areas of seagrass ranges that are currently unprotected.
Can I try to get one thing clear? So here I'm going to have a square. That's
right.
Conserve. That's
right.
All the new conservation.
Right.
President Obama just made a large conservation area and designated one. But, and you're saying, well, they've designated this area to protect, say, top predators or some species, mainly marine species, but not the grass. How can that be if the grass is there, or is the grass outside of it?
Yeah,
so,
so that's exactly how you describe it. So marine protected areas or marine reserves are just the same as we have on the terrestrial environment, national parks and game reserves. So we have that in the marine environment. So these are areas where fishing activities and other boating activities are restricted. So you need special permission to carry out any form of human activity, be it swimming, fishing, and any other human activities. But then, these reserves were initially designed with animals in mind, not plants. So it means that just like you drew the square, that square was designed to protect just animals, because people are often fascinated by animals.
Yes, sure.
You know, sharks and dolphins and, you know, manatees and you know, sea lions and so on. But then for plants, the plants that get protected inside that square were only incidentally included.
So it means
there is a whole vast portion of the seagrass ranges that is outside of that box.
Right.
And so it's been threatened because there's no protection. So it means that people can do all sorts of activities, dredging activities, overfishing, pollution, and so on. And so, but then it's also affecting all those animals that are inside of the box.
Right.
Because eventually, if the seagrasses are lost, then everything inside the box will also be affected, and that will have that cascading effect or a domino effect.
That's really an important thing. It's true. I'm sure they don't think about the grass being outside there on the perimeter or whatever, but it's much wider than that you have to take care of it. You go all over the world, I think, looking at this now, and I'm not sure, is this a new area of science to be investigating the seagrasses? And then I'd like to ask about what you're doing here.
Right. So that's a very interesting field. When I started, I'm learning a whole lot of things about seagrasses, and it's so an area that is relatively unexplored.
Ah.
So there's a whole lot that is not known about seagrasses. For example, we do not fully know how much of the seagrass ranges are expanding or contracting.
I see.
So because there's no much information. So my research is in the herbaria at Harvard. And so we use specimens of plants, of seagrasses that have been collected from all over the world over many years. And most of the time we pull this data together to have an idea of how the distribution of these species would have been in the past. There are now modeling techniques which we can extrapolate and predict, given the current data, to predict what will their ranges be in future, say in 50 years time or in 100 years time, especially given the ongoing changes in the climate.
Yes.
So climate change, for example, is leading to sea level rise and increased temperature, and this also affects plants. So it has been demonstrated that it affects animals in significant ways, but it remains still poorly understood what the impacts of climate change will be on the distribution of seagrasses in the future. So this is one area that is little explored. And then there are also other fields or other questions that is still poorly understood. For example, what are the genomic bases that predispose these plants to live in this kind of in this marine environment as opposed to their terrestrial relatives?
Mm-hmm.
What made them, could it be something in their genes that predisposes them to live in that kind of environment to be able to withstand changes in the osmotic pressure in the marine environment, as well as high tide and low tide? Most of them undergo these changes in the marine environment, low tide versus high tide.
Mm-hmm,
so,
mm-hmm.
But then they can still adjust their physiology
and temperature changes
to still adapt to this environment.
Yeah.
So, what is it about their genetic makeup that makes them to survive successfully in that kind of environment, of which other land plants cannot survive?
Right,
yeah.
That which is an interesting thing all by itself.
Right.
And now, in terms of like your work, were these the plants that are at least compromised? They're like all species are presumably not equal in terms of being adaptable to these sudden changes, pollution, environmental changes, and climate change. Is that the case, that they're not equal?
Right, yeah. So that's something very exciting about the seagrasses. Like I mentioned, they are not a taxonomic group, but then they are an ecological group, meaning that they evolve from different lineages. And so one thing is that they are not equally related. And so if they are not equally related, then it means the changes in the environment also impacts them differently as well. So that means, so in a recent study that we did, we found that seagrasses in the temperate regions of the world are much more unique compared to the ones that are in the tropical region, which is sort of a reversal of the situation on land.
Apparently it was a big surprise.
Yeah, where you have more diversity or unique species in the tropic versus the temperate regions. So we thought many things could have been responsible for that difference. And so one of the reasons is that perhaps in the temperate region in the past, there would have been a whole lot of diversity, but then due to the changes in the environment that happened years ago, like the glaciation and the closure of the isthmus of Panama, so that would have caused like a southward migration of some of the lineages, moving from the northern hemisphere and perhaps passing through the tropics, and they are found in the southern hemisphere, and we're actually able to pick up that signature of sort of a long distance migration in the seeds of the seagrasses, such that we found closely related species found on the opposite sides of the wall, like found in both northern and southern hemisphere and bridging the tropics. And so those could have been some of the events that played out to cause this kind of distribution pattern that we're finding, where you have more unique species in the temperate versus the tropical regions.
So you look at this like a long history, an evolutionary history part, but you're adding in climate changes from the remote past and how this might have affected this variability. And then I guess the whether they are able to adjust, what species are able to adjust to these kinds of stresses that there, you take that up too, is that correct?
Right.
So you're very comprehensive and have...
Yeah, so that's the exciting part of science today, like the integrative nature of science.
Yeah.
Because today it allows, with emerging technologies in genomics and geographic information systems, one can actually combine different techniques and try to answer a big question. And so that way you get a more complete view of the question that you are addressing. So in the case of seagrasses, we use the DNA data, and from the DNA data of seagrasses, we generated and reconstructed a phylogenetic tree or a relationship tree of all the species, and we combine geographic information data, the distribution maps, we link these maps to the phylogenetic tree, and we're able to now address the questions that we ask in our research. And that is something that is sort of trending today, the integrative nature, bringing molecular phylogenetics and GIS, the distribution data, in one paper and try to ask questions about the distribution and ecology of a given group, say seagrasses in this case.
That's really interesting. Then you represent this like new generation, and I would just like to underscore that for I don't know how long now, many fields are, that is, people become highly specialized, and even in one field, they can hardly talk to each other. And you represent this trend, as you say, with things that are much more comprehensive. They're looking at complex systems, and you're looking at it in a complex way.
Right.
So you represent like a whole new face to science, I suppose. It must be very exciting.
Right, yeah, so that's like the department that I am. It's organismic and evolutionary biology. So it's all about the whole organisms. And an organism in an ecosystem does not live in isolation. So many things play out, you know, to make the organism what it is. So it interacts with other organisms. It also interacts with other abiotic factors like, you know, oxygen, you know, the soil, water,
everything,
carbon dioxide, and so on. And that's the way I look at science today, because you have to combine all these pieces of evidence from different sources. That way it allows you to get a more holistic picture of what is happening to an organism compared to how it was in the past, where evidence often comes from just one source and so many other things are unknown about what could affect the distribution of species. So in our case, we combine the DNA data, the distribution data, we combine climatic data to try and sometimes even social data, like the use of these plants. How are they used? Could the uses by humans also predispose them to the way in which they are distributed today? So we try to explore all these different angles to see which one best explains what we are looking at.
That's just really very interesting. Unfortunately, we're out of time, and I hope you'll come back and do some more for us. But this is, we really appreciate this much more comprehensive approach, and just in time, because the way we have solved the problems we've created has also been very narrow.
Right.
And so this suggests that maybe we'll have a very different approach to solving the problems that we have created in climate and environment, and disrupting these systems, these ecological systems. Thank you ever so much for all of this great information.
It's a pleasure.
And I wish you the very best. You represent a whole new trend. And
thank you.
Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure.